today we celebrate, of course, you know, of course, St. John Lateran. And when I was ordained, I'm not sure. I think I knew that the Pope was the Bishop of Rome, but I certainly did not know that St. John Lateran is a cathedral. It's a basilica cathedral of Rome, which we celebrate today. And I've actually had dinner there. And it was built in 324 by the Lateran family. That's what it's named after. But I think this celebration is very much really about, it's a feast about church and about buildings that house God's people. All churches, like here at Sacred Heart. And that it's through Jesus Christ and his church that we are at home, that we are at home with God, that we are in God's great house. In the second reading, St. Paul uses the image of a building. He says, you are God's building. And he thinks of every church, every separate church, really is a part of one great building of God's house. And every Christian, all of us, are so built into that church. And of the whole church, there's one cornerstone. And that cornerstone, of course, is Jesus Christ. And that cornerstone holds everything together in that great building, God's church. And St. Paul thinks of that great building as all the churches are going on to form this one great building, being fitted all together. I think that word fitted is very important, that where all these churches are fitted together in the one church of Jesus Christ. And here at Sacred Heart, we are kind of fitted together. As many of you know, everybody, this part of the church is the older part of the church. It was built in 1957. And when John Kennedy was president, he went to church here. We don't know exactly how many times, three or four times, but we have several of his pews. So that was built in 1957. In 1987, this part of the church was fitted together with it. They were joined as one building. And then in 2008, we added the Adoration Chapel. So we have these three parts all fitted together. But our church here at Sacred Heart is also fitted in a way with our neighbors. With St. Louis, with Christ of the Desolate Palm Springs, to the east with St. Francis, Our Lady of Perpetual Health and Sermon, and Mac, Our Lady of Soledad and Coachella, all forming one church. And that is what the church should look like. It is all fitted together throughout the world. All the churches linked, where there is a place for all men and all women and children in the one family of God, all members of God's one house, all fitted together. And maybe, I think the word is an analogy. There is two twins, and their names are Ruth and Verna. And Ruth and Verna, like many twins, they share the same bedroom. They have the same toys. They share meals. They share TV shows, and they certainly, because they're twins, share birthdays. They share also the same womb before they were born. And they share something else about all of these things. They share the same heart. They are fitted together. Ruth and Verna are fused together from sternum to waist, fused from the back, each facing in opposite directions. And they have separate nervous systems. They have separate personalities. But they live and they share. They're sustained by one thing, by one three-chambered heart. Neither could survive without the other. And for Ruth and Verna, separation is not an option, and cooperation becomes an obligation. They learn to walk together. If you can imagine, they're back to back. When they walk sideways, almost like they're dancing. And they dance in the same direction. And they learn to make up for each other's weaknesses. Verna loves to eat. Ruthie finds sitting at the table a little dull. And remember, they're fused together. And so Ruthie, they eat only half a cup of fruit a day. No problem. For Sister Verna, they eat enough for both of them. And it's not unusual at all for Verna to have three bowls of cereal, two yogurts, and two pieces of toast just for breakfast. Ruthie tends to get a little restless while her sister eats. And Ruthie's been known to throw a bowl of ice cream across the room. And this leads to problems for Ruthie, but it also has consequences for her sister. When one has a timeout, so does the other. The innocent party doesn't complain, though. Both have learned early they're stuck together for the good and for the bad. And I think that's just one of the many lessons that these girls can teach us who live together in God's great house. We are fitted together with that one cornerstone who is Jesus Christ. And I was thinking as an aside, they're also fitted together for the sake of our church in one parking lot. At the end of Mass, to be honest, you people sometimes don't behave like you're fitted together. Catch on the drift. Maybe that's a good thing to remember. We have one house of God, and we're fitted together even in the parking lot. And after all, don't we share the same church? Aren't we covered by the same roof? Protected by the same walls? We don't sleep in the same bed, but we do sleep under the same sky. We aren't sharing one heart, but then again, maybe we are. Because doesn't everyone in this church hunger to be loved? And like Ruth and Verna, the Caddy friends, we also have the same Father, our Father in heaven. And we don't pray, do we, to my Father, we pray to our Father, our daily bread, our sins, our trespasses, our temptations, and deliver us. Whatever church we're at, we are together in God's great house. And during the Mass, we offer you this life and the saving power. When I was in Riverside, that was my first church. That was a long time ago, in the early 90s. I was at St. Catherine's. And I had some friends, they had a little daughter. Her name, I think was Molly. Molly was 7 years old, and she was in the second grade. One day, after checking with her parents, Molly invited another second grader over to spend the night. And there was no school the next day, so my friends let their daughter Molly and the other little 7-year-old stay up as late as they wanted. And a bedtime reprieve for a couple of 7-year-olds, that's like opening up Disneyland with free rides. The two outlasted Molly's parents, particularly her dad, went dozing off in his chair. And then he woke up at nearly midnight. And the dad said, "All right, girls, come on, so we've got to go to bed." And so the girls, groaning the entire time, changed their clothes, brushed their teeth, climbed in the saddle. And that's when Molly's little guest, the other 7-year-old, asked to call her mother. And at first the parents, remember it's after midnight, at first the parents declined, and the little girl's chin trembled, you can see it, and her eyes misted. And knowing that there were moments away from an explosion, they gave the little girl the phone. And you can envision what is happening at the other end of the line. The phone is ringing about 12:30, and a mom, probably nervously, reaches over her slumbering husband to grab the receiver. The little girl, the little aunt at the other end, did not even say hello. She said this, "Mommy, I want to come home." And with a teddy bear in one hand and the phone in the other, she pleaded her case. She was afraid of waking up in a strange room. This was not her house. She wanted her bed, her pillow, and most of all, her mommy. I can relate to Molly's friend. When it comes to resting your body, there is no house on your own. And on this feast of the Lateran Basilica, it is my hope that more of us will learn to dwell in this church, which is also your home. Don't just visit. It's not just a stop in or drop by for the Lord's Supper, but in your hearts, actually abide here. That is God's desire. And it's my prayer that the Holy Spirit will dwell in your mind, that you'll grow so at ease in the house of God that you'll never leave. And when you find yourself in another house, may you do what Molly's little friend did. Call home. Tell your Heavenly Father you can't rest in anyone's house but his. God will not mind the call. In fact, he's waiting by the phone. I need to conclude, certainly, with some thoughts that I have to share with you about Bishop Barnes. He came to our diocese 1 year after I was ordained. Actually about 16 months after I was ordained. And I know that in this hope, particularly on this Lateran Basilica, that we are one church, that we all fit together. And in this world, I looked this up today, there are 2,988 dioceses and archdioceses in the world. Sometimes they fit together, sometimes they do not. In our diocese, all of us priests get together every September for what we call a convocation. We do that every September. And at my first convocation, that was in September of 1991, the truth is, we were not, as a diocese, really one. We were not fitted together. All of us were not fitted together. And I remember hearing with sadness some of the priests, particularly older priests, and yes, many from Ireland, complaining about the diocese and complaining about the bishop and backstabbing and gossiping. And one of Bishop Barnes's great accomplishments, in my view, one that isn't mentioned much, one that you rarely hear, is that under Bishop Barnes, the parishes and the priests of our diocese pretty much get together as one diocese, part of one greater church. We're not perfect, we still complain, but overall we are fitted together, and here in the Coachella Valley, I do think that us parishes, we look out for each other. And our bishop, starting 25 years ago, is the genesis. He is the reason for that bonding. He also taught us, I remember, I can't remember who was speaking, but he used the expression to have an attitude of gratitude. I remember that. I think he's taught us to be grateful, to recognize that the only reason, I don't know if you ever thought of this, the only reason that any of us, including everyone in this church now, the only reason why any of us should exist at all lies in the mystery of why God should have desired to share the gift of life. We take every step in the energy of God's mercy. We breathe every breath in the atmosphere of God's grace. We think every thought. We feel every feeling through the power of God's creative love. We see each flower. We taste each drop of water. We sense the presence of each person around us through God's gift of consciousness. When we see all of this with our inner eye, we will need no one to tell us that we ought to be grateful. And through the years, Bishop Barnes has encouraged us to do just that. 2 months ago, we had another convocation. Actually, it's here in the desert. And I was able to get a private appointment with Bishop Barnes to speak to him about some stuff, some things. And at the end, I said this to him, hoping, praying that he'd say no. But I did ask him this. I said, do you need anything? And I was sincere. Do you need anything? Is there anything the Sacred Heart can do for you? And this is what Bishop Barnes did. He pointed upwards and he said, I need him, God. He provides for me. And Bishop Barnes certainly did not mean that he doesn't need this, far from it. But I think Bishop Barnes models for us a trust in God. A trust that for those of us who love this world, for those of us who grieve, that grieve for its sins and sorrows, that we have a stubborn faith that God can fix it, that God can rebuild it, that God can make it new, all of it, and especially the human part of our lives that we fit together living with God. And that what we want for our world is what the Bible calls shalom. Shalom is one of the greatest words in all tongues of the world. Shalom means peace, it means prosperity, it means joy. It means abounding joy, all fairly distributed in a world that is remodeled, a world made new, a world that will make God and all his children happy. And we have, and Bishop has taught this, a certainty surpassing all words and all thoughts, that we are participants in God's purpose. And in that certainty, there is a great peace, a great joy, a great trust, that fitting together, our diocese can help God, and they're making an immensely lovely world. A happy ending for a very sad world. A hope that this world, the one we live in and love so much now, this world, God's world, will end up far better than ever, and better than ever, forever. And in truly closing, in our Universal Church on this St. Lateran Day, for the past 25 years, our bishop has made our churches fit. Our people fit, our diocese fit, and with gratitude and trust that God will remodel this world. And for all of this, we owe our bishop not just congratulations for 25 years, but I think even more importantly, simply a very heartfelt and sincere thank you.
Thank all of you for your presence and your participation in this evening's liturgy. I know it's an effort to come out later at night. I'm paying, and some have come from distances. Really does good to my heart to know that you would make that kind of fine commitment to be here. Así es que quisiera darle mis más sinceras gracias por el esfuerzo que han hecho para acompañarnos a nosotros y también esta celebración de la liturgia. Sé que ha sido para algunos un sacrificio de venir de lejos para estar aquí a tiempo y celebrar esta misa. Quisiera reconocer a los sacerdotes que están aquí, pero as the priests that are here present, the Jesuit parish is here, some of the parishes here in the valley. And we have representing the parish of Our Lady, Our Lady of Solitude in Palm Springs, Father David Coxon, and Father Van Patten. And representing St. Teresa's in Palm Springs, Father John Kaplan. St. Mary's in Yucca Valley of the Martin. Representing from Hot Springs and St. Elizabeth Perry, Father Conn. From St. Louis in the Cathedral City, Father Luis and Father Anthony. Francis and La Quinta, Father James and Father Peter. And the Vicar for Rain of the Lower Desert, and from Our Lady of Grateful Help, Father Alex and also Father And of course, Father Rigo is here from Hofstadt and many of the parishes. And I say this for next to the last because it's something. From St. Joan of Arc in life, Father And from coming east or west, one of your neighbors, miles and miles away, from Coachella, Our Lady of Soledad, Mother Guy. And our host and our followers tonight from here, Sacred Heart, Father Hubbard. I'd like to ask the deacons that are here. We have deacons here at the altar. We have deacons in the assembly with the deacons and their spouses are here. Please stand and show your appreciation for your vocation. Are there any religious sisters here? I didn't spot any, but well, we've got them too. Luis Marquis for 25 años. Me aguanta. Esta semana me ha aguantado más de salud. Les agradezco el cariño que siempre han mostrado, el apoyo, la confianza y el perdón también que han ofrecido las veces que he fallado. Quiero mucho esta iglesia. El Señor me ha confiado este pueblo y he tratado de hacer lo mejor, pero yo sé que como hermano he fallado en cosas. Y si les he lastimado de cualquier modo, les pido su perdón. Hay que seguir adelante. Hay que dar un buen ejemplo, un buen buen testimonio de la misericordia y el amor de Dios, especialmente para con sus hijos, sus nietos. Tienen que conocer a Jesús, lo tienen que conocer, no nomás saber de él, sino conocer de él. Y nosotros, que conocemos bien, hay que darles ese encuentro para que caminen en el camino del Señor. Estamos perdiendo muchos jóvenes. Están buscando algo. Y lo que necesitan, lo que les falta es encontrar al Señor Jesús. Pero somos nosotros que tenemos que ayudarnos a hacer ese encuentro. Cada vez que vamos a una celebración y nos sentimos bien, porque el Señor nos ha dado su presencia y su gracia, nosotros tenemos que ser algo en su nombre. No nomás festejar algo, sino de comprometernos a hacer algo. Por la gracia, la bendición que hemos recibido. Yo les pido, sinceramente, en esta celebración, le hagan un compromiso a pedir por los jóvenes y por las vocaciones. Les pido eso. My brothers and sisters, I've been in a bishop for 25 years, and I know you've put up with a lot. And I apologize for the times that I've erred, and I ask for your forgiveness for the times that I think I've said and made a decision that has hurt you. I apologize and I ask for your forgiveness. I can do anything with any intention of hurting anyone. But we all make mistakes. And I ask you to be patient with me. I only have a few more years left. Be patient with me. You know, we went to a lot of celebrations, and we feel good, especially if the food is good, and the food here was the best. And they get better than that. If the company's good, if the music was good, the music here was great. Feeling good. Just feel good. Feel at peace. Feel grateful. Feel like we've received something. That's not good. We know we've been blessed. We know we've been blessed. And our God is continually giving us everything. We need to, any time we have a celebration like this, we need to commit ourselves to the mission once again. We don't do this just to feel good. We do this to own the mission of being missionary disciples. That's what we're called to do, to take this back out into the world. I ask in a special way that you who have received God's word tonight in the sacrament of the body and blood of the Son, and have been filled with the presence of the Lord in the assembly that has gathered here, I ask that you go home and pray for the youth and the children of our families. They desperately need our prayers, and they need a good example from us. They are searching. So many have left our church. They don't find any relevance or any meaning. They don't find authenticity from us or believers. I ask that as you go home and you thank God for the beautiful Mass that you have today, that you commit yourself to being a true missionary disciple and giving witness to Christ. Let these young people not only know about Christ, but let them know Him in their heart, because they have encountered Him in you, in the way you live your life. Let us do something for the young people of our families and of our communities. The Lord has entrusted them to us. Let us recommit ourselves to be witnesses of God's love, and God's mercy, and God's presence, especially to our children, our grandchildren.
professionally done, food is excellent, it's warm food, you can have, you're good at dinner. We have food, enough food to play for 400 or 500 people. We have soda and water, we have a little bit of heavy water, some wine and cerveza and some beer. Nos abrimos recepción, inmediatamente en nuestro salón. Nosotros tenemos la comida gratis, la comida es excelente, el soda es gratis, vino es cerveza, no es gratis, pero es muy barato. You're all welcome, bienvenido, boys. Okay, Bishop Barnes, thank you again for privilege and blessing.